Well, hi guys, it's that time. It's our Bible teaching snippet of the day. Well, today I want to keep talking about the subject I've been on, talking to you about living off of what Genesis 1:29, what God said was His will for human beings to eat, which is fruits, vegetables, things grown in the dirt and out of the dirt, not living beings who have been murdered, killed, so we can slaughter them to eat them, okay? Now, let me say this because I think it's so, so important, guys, okay? The Bible says here, I'll quote this scripture. I posted it the other day. All things are permissible, but not all things are profitable, okay? So let's don't get into somebody's sinning and somebody's going to go to hell. You know, where we're really at is that some are living a little closer to what God's original plan is for us, and some of us are still trapped in a pagan lifestyle of meat eating. I know that I am guilty. I was guilty, but at the same time, I was innocent for not understanding because I lacked knowledge. And here's why. It seems on a surface, just reading and looking at the Bible, and our churches don't do real good at teaching us on a deeper level, that it almost looks like in the Bible that what God wants is for us to slaughter and kill and eat animals. But what I have found is that that's not really the case. God said in the beginning what He wanted in Genesis 1:29. I've given you all the plants, now eat all you want. And what we find in the Bible, when we start thinking that the Bible is teaching us to eat animals, what we find is that people who eat a high meat diet have all kinds of debilitating, chronic, fatal, terminal diseases, from heart disease, cancer, diabetes, hardening of the arteries, liver failure, all kinds of stuff, everything, dementia, Alzheimer's, all of these different diseases that not only people that are on plant-based diets, they don't ever have these diseases. See, my thoughts are I want to stay healthy, not get sick and figure out how to get out of sickness jail, right? But the people that are sick from eating a high animal diet can reverse these health problems they have by going on a plant-based diet. We call it vegan these days. And over, if you go back in the older days of the Bible and stuff, when someone was called a vegetarian, that really meant eating plant-based, eating vegetables. I mean, if you really start pulling the layers back and looking at it, okay? But what I have found is that the Bible really doesn't teach us that as much as we read into and enter it into believing that's what God wanted for mankind, and that it's really what mankind wanted for themselves, and God is working within our poor choices, and not we're not doing what He wants, what is best, according to Genesis 1:29, or according to the end, when it will go back to being like the beginning, right? When all things will be reconciled, all right? Because in the end, we'll all be vegan once again, right? But what I have found is that here's the thing. Our life experience of eating meat contradicts what we think the Bible says. That, because look, if God has ordained and wanted us to eat meat, high quantities of meat, shouldn't the result of that be health and wholeness? Because that's what God is sozo, health. He saves us, makes us whole, protects us. So what we see in reality doesn't match up with what we think or what we've been taught the Bible teaches, right? We don't see that in scientific and medical research. Medical research has proven for decades now that a plant-based diet will not only keep people from getting debilitating diseases, but if they will stop eating meat, their body will heal itself by going to a plant-based diet. So with that 4-minute intro today, I do want to talk. I mentioned Romans 8:22 yesterday, and I want to go a little deeper and read this to you, and I'm going to read it out of the Passion Translation and a little of it out of the J.B. Phillips. Here we go. The entire universe is standing on tiptoe, yearning to see the unveiling of God's glorious sons and daughters. For against its will, the universe itself has had to endure the empty futility resulting from the consequences of human sin. But now, with eager expectation, all creation longs for freedom from its slavery to decay, and to experience with us the wonderful freedom coming to God's children. To this day, we are aware of the universal agony and groaning of creation, as if it were in the contractions of labor for childbirth. Okay, nowhere in the Bible tells us that us stepping into being God's sons and daughters, and I've taught this for 3 years, and I'm not moving off of this. I know that what Jesus did for us is he brought us back into adoption, that we are sons and daughters of God right now, not sometime in the future, okay? This is not some dream in the future. This is today, and us stepping into who we are right here, right now. There's scripture of that. We are sons and daughters right here, right now. We are sons and daughters just like Jesus, okay? Now, let me read to you verse 21, 22 in the J.B. Phillips. And the hope is that in the end, the whole of created life will be rescued from the tyranny of change and decay and have its share in the magnificent liberty, freedom, which can only belong to the children of God. It is plain to anyone with eyes to see that at the present time, all created life groans in a sort of a universal travail. Do you just, and I'm not trying to attack anybody here. Please hear my heart. But you know what? That verse is so clear to me now on this side of understanding what God wants for us. God wants us to work with him to heal the earth, to heal his creation. We're the ones that trashed it and destroyed it, right? We're kind of like little kids in our room. Mommy and Daddy wants us to participate in cleaning our room up, and God wants us to participate in bringing out of slavery all of creation, of what man put it in, from what Adam did, okay? And part of that is he wants us to quit living a violent lifestyle of killing. And that would include stop killing animals for a desire to eat meat. It's not a need. We can get food anywhere. No one has to kill an animal to get food any longer. That is just absolutely not true. So from that, okay, what I want to do is I talked to you some yesterday about how let me find my note because I got this. I read this to you from a guy who isn't even a Christian, but he wrote an article talking about how the early Christians were all vegetarian. And I read you a little bit of this. The quote that I read that Ted, the non-Christian that wrote this little article, and I can post the link to the article, okay? He's quoting Stephen Rossen, R-O-S-E-N, from the book Food for the Spirit, and it's copyrighted at 1987. And it says here, I'm going to read it again, okay, that the early Christian fathers adhered to a meatless regime or lifestyle. Let me say it like that. I'm not good with that word. Many early Christian groups supported the meatless way of life. In the writings of the early church indicate that meat eating was not officially allowed until the 4th century. Okay, so till the 4th century, all the leaders were required to be vegetarians, nonviolent, eating no meat, okay? And they taught the congregations to abstain and not to eat meat because it was partnering with evil for us to do that. Now, I understand some of us may have a problem really believing that or accepting it, but it's all right there, guys. I have spent so many hours studying this, and I've got books and books and research, and I've actually got old copies of the Gospels that don't talk about Jesus eating lamb. Gospels don't say Jesus ate lamb, but your Bible does not say Jesus ever ate any meat. In fact, the one place it talks about him eating fish, I'm going to talk about that next week. But anyway, I have copies of the old Syriac Gospels, and there's no indication whatsoever in any of that that Jesus ever ate, and he condemned eating meat in some of those scriptures, and they are in our Bibles, okay? But that's a different teaching. I need to keep going today with what I've got written down. Okay, I'm going to pick up. Eating meat was not officially allowed till the 4th century, and I told you yesterday what happened in the 4th century. Constantine calls himself converting. He don't even call himself converting. We called him converting to Christianity. Constantine never converted to Christianity. He drew Christianity into a pool of other pagan beliefs and integrated it, okay? And he had to make some changes in Christianity for it to line up with what those other pagan religions were already in place in Rome, was teaching people. And part of that was the eating of meat, okay? But let me keep reading. When the Emperor Constantine decided that his version of Christianity would be the version for everyone, meat-eating interpretation of the Bible became the official creed of the Roman Empire, and the vegetarian Christians had to practice in secret or risk being put to death for heresy. It is said that Constantine used to pour molten lead down their throats if they were captured. Okay, my next one I want to talk about down here, to cite another example, in southern France, a group of aborigines, vegetarians, were put to death by hanging in 1052 because they refused to kill a chicken. Now, I want to talk to you about that. So we see right here, history shows us, okay, so when Constantine comes in and he decides he's pulling Christianity into his pagan belief system as one of the religions that's part of the Roman Empire, okay, he's the one that set up the first council at the Council of Nicaea, the Nicene Council, in 325, okay? And then, let me see what else I've got for you. I've got some more notes on this as well. Let me find those real quick. I've got some notes from some things. There's a guy by the name of Reverend Gideon Jasper Richard Osley, who's done a lot of research on this, and he says, some are not aware that after the Council of Nicaea, the manuscripts of the New Testament were considerably tampered with. What these correctors that were put in place by Constantine, the emperor, with the approval of the then Catholic Church, the Western Church leaders, okay, some of those leaders were replaced by Constantine's own leaders and integrated, okay, that's what Rome used to do, guys, they integrate the rest of the world into their belief systems, okay. These correctors who were put in place cut out of the Gospels with minute care certain teachings of our Lord, which they did not propose to follow, namely, those against the eating of flesh and taking of strong drink. So he's researched, and I have these because he lists where he got his research. So what happened is we've had a cut and paste job done in our New Testament that lead us to believe that God himself wants us to eat meat, right? And that Jesus was a meat eater, and that this is part of Christianity. But prior to Constantine and him fiddling with our Bibles, and look, I've already talked to you about the changes in the Bible that St. Jerome made right here in the end of the... St. Jerome started his translation in 380 A.D. of the Latin Vulgate. We're sitting right here at 325 when Constantine and the Roman government gets involved in Christianity to turn it into a pagan religion that matches the other religions, okay? All of this is out there, guys, okay? I'm wanting you to understand that, you know, Jesus did not teach killing. Jesus did not teach violence, killing, and eating of flesh. Let me see. I'm going to close today with one quote that I want to use. This is out of the Old Syriac Aramaic manuscript in the Gospel of Luke. Here you go. This is Luke 21:34, okay? And it says, "Be on guard so that your hearts do not become heavy with the eating of flesh and with the intoxication of wine and with the anxiety of the world. Okay? This is the old Syriac version of Luke 21:34, and you see the part about not eating flesh that was spoken by Jesus has been removed. Listen, I got to run today. I love you, and I'll pick back up on this tomorrow. I love you. Bye-bye.